Someone who knows about Kenyans and, of course, a patriot in his own right is Mr. Megona Megona. And he's with us in the studio. Very good morning to you, sir.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
I'm good.
Now, let's go straight into it. First of all, let's just ask, how successful was the first book, Peeling Back the Mask?
Very successful.
Mm-hmm.
I think the most successful book in Africa in the last few decades.
All right. How many copies did you sell? Perhaps, do you have the figures?
You know, we can't give you the figures, but I can tell you that millions of people have read the book.
Mm-hmm.
Whether they pirated it or bought it legally is of no consequence. The fact is, when a writer writes, they want their books read. And I think mine is one that has been read by almost everyone. And I think that makes any writer, any legitimate, serious writer very happy, and I'm happy.
All right.
You have a new book out, Kidneys for the King, very interestingly titled after your own kidneys, in fact.
Yes, yes. Fortunately, they've not been able to get my kidneys.
Fortunately, they're still in your body.
Yes.
Tell us a bit more about it.
This book is a sequel, it's a follow-up to Peeling Back the Mask. When I released Peeling Back the Mask, I explained to the country and the world that I intended to publish a bigger book than what came out. But you realize that Peeling Back the Mask is 601 pages, and that's the maximum my publisher could produce. I had said that I had two other books that were coming up, and I think people laughed it off and thought that I was just joking. Then the reaction was very vicious. There were supports, but there was also a lot of backlash. Remember Salman Rushdie, the one who published Satanic Verses?
Mm-hmm.
He received death threats and had a fatwa on his head from the Ayatollah of Iran. I had worse. I did not just have a fatwa from Raila Odinga. I had demonstrations. My effigies were burned. They buried a coffin. They attacked me physically in Kisumu and Mombasa. They have been trying to slaughter me in the social media, in the compromised media in Kenya, both electronic and paper media, hard copy media. And out of all this, I decided that I was going to do a sequel faster than I thought I would do it, because I did not plan originally to publish the next book before these elections. But because of the viciousness, I realized that this country has not changed, and that you need to precipitate that change by deforming the status quo, by exposing its rot, by exposing the excesses in this society, by exposing the double and duplicitous, you know, chattering classes, including people like you. I'm not saying Capital FM.
Thank you for clarifying that.
It's duplicitous. But the media in Kenya is quite suffocatingly, despicably duplicitous and quite compromised in a way that is frightening, because we have the Bill of Rights and we expect the media, for out of everyone else, to at least embrace that and start recognizing that everyone has a right to think the way they want to think.
Mm-hmm.
And they have a right to write, they have a right to speak, they have a right to associate with whomsoever they want to associate with, as long as they are not committing a crime. And all I did was publish a book that could not be a crime. And if somebody felt offended with the book, they should have gone to court, but they didn't. So anyway, that's what the book is about. These excesses, and then of course I go back to the political situation and I analyze the contestants, currently the political contestants, those running for president, because that is probably the most important thing happening right now, and discuss them in detail, particularly the subject I know best, Raila Odinga. Now people are saying, why do you focus on Raila Odinga so much? Well, why not? Raila Odinga is running for the presidency of this country. That's like the gold Olympic medal in the world. If you're running for president, whether United States, Germany, whatever, that is the ultimate power. That person needs to be vetted thoroughly, because after they are elected, if they are elected, we give them so much privilege and power that they can also abuse. And if we are able to control and preempt that kind of abuse, that's good for the country. And that's what I'm trying to do. And I'm doing it with facts, I'm doing it with evidence, I'm doing it with interviews from people who know this man, like in this book, the last chapter. Mm-hmm. I've interviewed people who went to school with him, elementary school, grade or standard 4, all the way to Eastern Germany. I've interviewed people who helped him steal the molasses plant in Kisumu.
Why not Uhuru Kenyatta? Why not Martha Karua? Why?
Yeah, because first of all, Raila Odinga is a prime minister. He's the prime minister of Kenya. It's almost, he shares power with Kibaki. So he's a principal. Uhuru Kenyatta and the rest are after Raila Odinga, actually, in terms of power. That's number one.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, Raila Odinga is the one I advised. He's the one I know like the back of my hand. I don't know these other characters like the back of my hand. Three, he's supposed to be a leading candidate. The so-called leading, he's saying himself that he's already won. So I'm saying, fine, let's interrogate you. Now, a lot of people are saying, why don't I write about Ruto or whatever? Well, I'm not stopping anybody from writing about anybody. I am only writing about things I know. You know, as a writer,
the person that I know.
If you write about things you don't know, there are botanists, they only write about botany. There are zoologists, they only write about zoology. They're political scientists, they can only write about things that they know.
Yes.
Now, I'm writing about subjects and things I know, so that when you interrogate me, like you will try to do today, I can be able to make sense, I can be able to discuss these people comprehensively, I can help in the public discourse, so that at the end of the day, when the discussion is finished and people reflect on what has just happened, they can say, I can take 1, 2, 3, 4 points.
Mm-hmm.
And that would help.
Now, some would question the timing of the release of this second book, Kidneys mm-hmm. for the King.
Mm-hmm.
The first book, like you said, was very controversial. Mm-hmm. And as you've pointed out rightly, people have the right to freedom of speech.
Mm-hmm.
You exercised yours in a book. Others exercised theirs in demonstration.
Right.
But this book comes out a few weeks mm-hmm. before
mm-hmm.
the presidential elections, well, indeed, mm-hmm. the elections of Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
And there is the question on a lot of people's minds whether you are in somebody's pay or whether there is an agenda greater than a writer writing his book.
First of all, the people should know this is my sixth book, okay? I have now published 6 books. I started publishing, I published my first book in 1994. Now, clearly, I did not publish that because of Raila Odinga. No, I just want to put context that I did not start writing yesterday.
Proceed.
I have written since I was a high school student. I started contributing as a columnist for the Standard newspaper when I was in high school, actually secondary school. Before I finished Form 4, I was already writing for a national newspaper. So this is a man who started writing as a boy and has written throughout his life. So that's number one.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, we read newspapers every day. They have not stopped publishing newspapers because we are having an election. People read every day. People must continue to read every day. People must continue to write every day. People must continue to think every day. Now, writers write, and if they are serious writers, should be writing every day. Now, there is no bad or good time for publishing a book. If anything, we should be publishing more books, more thought-provoking articles before elections. Because if I wait until after the election, and assuming I had something important to say, and I did not say it, and this thing could have helped somebody make a decision, I would have failed. Because then that person can turn around and say, why didn't you give me that information? You
before.
Are the one who had it and you kept it.
Mm-hmm.
Why are you telling me now after I've made the wrong decision?
So in answer to the question, are you hired by somebody else to do this?
I could never be hired by somebody else. You see, this is the most pathetic, despicable kind of garbage that Raila Odinga is good at. You see, the other day he said Kimemia, the head of the military, and the NSIS are trying to rig him out. How irresponsible and reckless can you be? This is a core principle. He's the prime minister of the country. These are his subordinates. These are civil servants he can simply call to his office. He can also have this discussion with the president, but he goes to the press. Then the other day, he attacked the IEBC. Why doesn't he have a meeting with Hassan Isaac and his team and discuss these matters? If he's a serious manager, if this man is ready to be the commander-in-chief, a potential commander-in-chief, an Obama preparing for an election, cannot attack the chief of general staff just weeks before election. That would be criminal. Raila is doing it every day. Then yesterday, you saw what they did. There was an allegation that the chief justice is threatened. Before investigations are done, before handwriting experts come to tell us whether or not, in fact, this thing came from the Bungiki, because we don't know. As a lawyer, just because you tell me this thing is from here, how do we know? So until that is done, they have jumped into the fray. This is irresponsible recklessness, and the man is just not capable of governing. Now, why shouldn't I say that? Why do I need to be paid to say that? Now, I have said many things against Ouru. Was he paying me to say this? No. I was saying them because I believed them. And I will speak the truth regardless. And they can do whatever they want to try to defang me, but they won't be able to.
And that is your opinion. We're going to be holding Gunabiguna with us in the next link. Many questions coming in, a lot of sentiments coming in as well from listeners on Twitter and on SMS, and we shall be having him back in a short while before I'm being accused of suffocatingly being duplicitous, as the word is. Coming up in a short while, Capital of the Morning.